I'm an immigrant here. I moved from Ireland 10 years ago. And one of the things I love about New York City is that I'm still a New Yorker. Like, you land here and you're here 5 minutes and you're a New Yorker. The number one criterion for being a New Yorker is wanting to be a New Yorker. I really love it. As Lin-Manuel Miranda says, this is the greatest city in the world. I'm a site reliability engineer, and I'm especially interested in what happens when things fail and the contingency plans we use when something breaks. And a few months ago, I was walking around the city, which is beautiful, in September, October, the light's all soft, and the buildings look really gorgeous, and I started really noticing the fire escapes. And I thought, these are a contingency plan, too. They're for incident response. You don't use a fire escape until all your regular methods of getting out of the building have failed. So I started reading about fire escapes. Before I talk about that, though, let's talk content. I'm looking at disaster prevention and disaster recovery and software by looking at parallels in building fires. This talk will include stories of some of the worst fires in the history of New York City. Some of these are not pretty. None of these are pretty. I've intentionally kept this as low on vivid details as possible, but we will be looking at why fires started and spread and how people died. And there are some pictures of buildings on fire, though nothing really lurid, but there are pictures. If you have raw feelings related to recent fires like Ghost Ship or that devastating fire in the Bronx just before Christmas, this could be rough, and honestly, if you'll be more comfortable skipping this, I will not be offended at all. Just leave it anytime if you want to. I will even tell you what I'm going to say so you don't feel like you're missing anything. You still get your money's worth. This is my thesis. Fire escapes are a hacky bit of afterthought tacked onto the outside of the building after the building is finished or released, if you will. It's worth making them as good as possible if you're relying on them, but you will prevent more fires if you build better buildings. Similarly, incident response is a hacky bit of afterthought, often tacked on long after the software is released. And again, great incident response is better than crap incident response, but you'll prevent more outages if you build better software. Finally, buildings have an extremely detailed fire code. We don't really have an extremely detailed systems engineering code for software, and maybe we should have. Okay, now I'm going to say exactly the same thing, but take 35 minutes to do it. So, fire escapes were really only built in New York for 100 years. They weren't common until the 1860s. And in the 1960s, they stopped being allowed in new construction. But in that time, they just completely changed the face of the city. And they really captured the imagination of people who live here and visit. Like, if you go to Flickr and you search for fire escapes New York City, you get 13,000 pictures. I did not include them all here. I thought about it. There's some debate now about whether we should start removing them in places where the building's been upgraded and they're not needed anymore, or whether they should be preserved as part of the city's history. I think at least some of them should be preserved. Like, that's really beautiful, right? And I think this one's really beautiful as well. They made an effort for this one to have it match the style of the building. It doesn't seem like a separate thing tacked onto the end, and I think that's good. But most of the time, the people adding the fire escape didn't think of it as part of the building. As this quote says, the facade of the building was architecture, but the fire escape was law, and it was added at the end. It was an external contingency plan, not part of the real structure of the building, and I think that's why they ended up not being successful. But I'm jumping to the end. Let's look at the evolution of New York City's fire code. So, by the way, my great fear now is that there's like a building historian in the room who will listen to all of this and be like, nope, that's not what happened. If so, please forgive my error as building historian. I read a lot to prepare this. I don't actually know anything about this topic, or I didn't 6 weeks ago. I basically read about fire escapes for 6 weeks. And I've tried to fact check what I say, but I've almost certainly made some mistakes. If there's stuff I can fix, I would love if you would come tell me at the break. I will go hang out in that corner and you can come tell me what I got wrong with the fire escapes. And I would actually really appreciate that. Everyone else, don't quote me on any of this. It's true enough to be illustrative, but I may have made mistakes. Okay, history. We're skipping the Great Fire of 1776 and jumping straight to 1835 in the financial district. This is a commercial, not a residential area, and as a result, the number of fatalities was comparatively low. It was like two people, which is still like two people, but this is mostly remembered as a fire that cost a ton of money. The total cost was $20 million, which, to put into context, was three times the cost of the entire Erie Canal, which had opened 10 years earlier. Almost 700 buildings were destroyed. The city had 26 fire insurance companies, and this fire put 23 of them out of business. So what happened? A burst gas pipe in a maze of warehouses. So these are wooden warehouses full of extremely expensive, extremely flammable things for sale, like lace and silks and musical instruments. winter, the gale force winds, the rivers have frozen over, and the fire spread really, really quickly. Inside 2 hours, it covers 17 city blocks, which is about 13 acres, I'm told, which is most of the financial district. The city's water supplies were low because the city didn't really have a reliable water supply yet. And again, it's freezing, so the firefighters had to cut through the ice on the river to get water to fight the fire. And the wind's blowing and the water's like pulling back with ice into their faces. At the time, it was really common to use gunpowder to blow up buildings that couldn't be saved and stop the fire from spreading. But 2 days earlier, there had been a bad fire, and they'd used up all the gunpowder. And they'd also used up the firefighters' energy. They were exhausted. They'd taken the entire force of 1,500 people to fight this thing. I mean, I've read nothing that said that they didn't do well, because like, firefighters are badasses, right? A firefighter on their worst day, it's just cool anyway. And they fought the fire for 15 hours despite being exhausted, until Marines from the Navy Yard arrived with more gunpowder. And they blew up a bunch of buildings along Wall Street and stopped the fire. So, two contingency plans failed. Water, gunpowder. There wasn't enough of either. And having no gunpowder meant no failure planes. Nothing to stop it spreading. So as a result of the fire, they built a bigger force, they moved to using only professionals, not volunteers, and they got better equipment. They also built the Croton Dam and Aqueduct, so they had a reliable water supply for the first time in the city, which, you know, is good for several reasons. But as well as better incident response, they took the opportunity to build a more resilient city. So the fire spread fast because the buildings were made of wood, they rebuilt with stone. And this paid off 10 years later, when there was another enormous fire, called the Great Fire of 1845, kind of originally. This was a really bad fire, 30 people died. But it didn't spread as far or as fast because it stopped when it hit those new stone and brick buildings. Jump forward 25 years, it's 1860. We're gonna talk about tenements. Tenements were these extremely dense, extremely terrible housing. They're mostly in the Lower East Side, but other places in the city too. I had read about them before, but I hadn't realized the scale of them. In the 1860s, nearly 500,000 people, which was more than half the city, lived in tenements. The population of New York City doubled every decade between 1800 and 1880, every decade, twice as many people. And maybe you've seen this with teams and with software systems. When you're growing rapidly, you can build some technical debt and some cultural problems. And this was the case of New York City. Landlords made more accommodation by splitting their big rooms into small rooms, mostly without any windows or any ventilation. And these were awful places to live. They were full of crime, they were filthy, there was disease, and every report about them mentioned that they were fire traps. In 1860, two bad tenement fires happened back to back. The first one on Elm Street, which is now Lafayette, started in a bakery on the ground floor of a six-story building. The baker was storing a lot of hay and wood shavings in the building, as you do, and when they burned, they made really dense smoke. And the smoke got to the top of the building, you know, before the fire did, and that killed a bunch of people. The wooden stairway burned away, and people were trapped on the top. The roof was four stories higher than any of its neighbors, so whereas typically you might have gone and escaped across the roofs, there was just nowhere to go. Firefighters came, but their ladders only went up to the fourth floor. This is a six-story building. And somewhere between 10 and 30 people died. The news report is a bit vague about this one. A month later, on West 45th Street, four houses burned. All four of them had these emergency hatches called scuttles that were state-of-the-art for fire technology at the time, which is like a ladder up to a trapdoor on your roof. But the ladders were all missing, so people couldn't get up there. And at least 10 people died. These escape plans, the ladders and the scuttles on the roof, they had worked fine for a previous iteration of shorter New York City buildings, but they hadn't been updated for the new shape of the city. And I'm sure people have noticed, but until there's a disaster, it doesn't get any priority. So the city immediately, like inside a month or something, they passed a law to make the tenements better. They even they put an injunction on building new tenements until the law was passed. Now houses for more than eight families, which is sort of specific, had to have fireproof stairs either inside or outside. What's frustrating about this is that they already knew. 4 years earlier, a commission had reported that if there was a fire, the tenants on the sixth and seventh floors of tenements had basically no chance of survival. They recommended fireproof stairs, but nothing happened until a bunch of people died. 7 years later, the draft riots, which are a whole separate awful thing I'm not going to talk about, led to the Tenement House Act. This act had extremely good goals, and it was extremely unsuccessful. The act said that tenements had to have fire escapes, but it didn't really spell out what that meant. They didn't have to make anyone safer. So landlords put up fire escapes that couldn't hold the number of people in the building, or that weren't really attached to the wall very well, or they fed into tiny spaces that couldn't hold all the people who were trying to get out. And what is a fire escape? Is a rusty ladder a fire escape? Oh yeah, definitely. So we're going to take a diversion and look at some fire escape paths, which I'm going to admit, these are not especially relevant to DevOps, but they're delightful. So, you know, so this is our ladder with a counterweight. Imagine climbing down from the 7th floor of your building on this with your 6 children in a dress that went to your aunt's. This is some of the same properties. It's a rope ladder that attaches to a windowsill. This is a parachute that rolls up very small. The idea was that you would carry it with you everywhere in case you were in any tall building fire. According to this passage, a person desiring to escape seizes one member of the cord rope or chain, as shown in figure 1, and forthwith jumps out the window. Like, I'm looking at this thing, I did not want to forthwith jump out of anything. Annabella's fire escape was a bridge that you would sling from your building to another building. It had side rails, so it was only moderately terrifying. This is good if you want to fight super villain crime, probably. And this one, okay, you might think that this is just a parachute helmet, but it is not. It is a parachute helmet and a pair of very bouncy shoes. Finally, I have read this patent 3 times, and I'm fairly convinced the guy invented a rope. It is the most Silicon Valley invention of 1882. So let's be clear, rope was a very popular type of fire escape. In fact, it was state-of-the-art for hotels. And I don't mean a ladder made of rope, I mean literally a rope. Every hotel room had to have a rope, and that was the fire code. Even at the time, people found that pretty terrible. And this is a snarky cartoon from a magazine called Pug, which it's probably hard to see, but you get the gist. A whole lot of people trying to use the ropes. To zoom in on one, this lady's saying, "Slide down a rope in my nightdress with everybody looking at me? Never, I'll be cremated first." I'm like, fair enough, these escape plans are designed for the best case, which is someone with good upper body strength and agility who isn't wearing a skirt or carrying a child. If your disaster plan only works for the easiest case, it's not a good plan. I want to emphasize, though, a rope is better than nothing. Actually, all of these fire escapes, even Mr. Parachute Hat, is probably better than nothing. Once the fire has started, you will be glad of your parachute hat. But these escape plans are not where I would put my energy if I wanted to talk to a people die in building fires. But this is where the law focused. Anyway, the Tenement Test Act. Even with fire escapes, tenements were terrible. They're badly constructed, they're overcrowded, there's no ventilation. And I find this amazing. It was perfectly legal to store lots and lots of combustible materials in them. One of the things the Tenement Act said was, every room now has to have a window. But like it didn't explain what even is a fire escape. It also didn't define what even is a window. So the landlords cut holes in interior walls so you could see your neighbors and said, great, you have interior windows now. Like a decade later, the law was like, sigh, exterior windows. And the landlords started constructing buildings with air shafts. And here's a picture of one here. It's just a little narrow gap between buildings. So bear in mind, there's no indoor plumbing in any of these buildings yet. And bathroom is down 6 flights of stairs, and now you have an air shaft. So you can imagine where that goes, right? One article I read described them as festering tubes of disease, which I think is very poetic. And it said that they provided just enough oxygen and maybe methane to help spread fires more quickly. So that's something. Anyway, many of the fire escapes just led down into this hole, and there's no way out from there. A later law said that your fire escape had to have a cast iron sign saying you could be fined if you put obstructions on it. And, that's fair, because usable fire escapes are better than unusable fire escapes. But again, it was perfectly legal to run your explosive business out of the basement. And tons of residential fires started because people were deep frying crawlers, which I believe are like donuts, if I'm not actually sure. And anyway, the regulations weren't enforced, so nobody cared. Move on to 1876, and this is a staggering number. 278 people died in Cadman Plaza in Brooklyn in the 3rd worst theater fire in US history. At the time, this is the worst one. The worst one happens in 1900, the 3rd worst. This is the worst then. The actual worst will happen in 1903 in Chicago. The final act of the play was about to start, and the stage manager noticed a very small fire to the left of the stage. And it was typical to keep buckets of water there, but they weren't there. There was a fire hose, but there was so much scenery in the way that he wasn't able to get to it. So he asked a couple of carpenters to put out the fires by like beating them with sticks. Beating the fire, not the carpenters. That didn't work, and it actually spread sparks, which set fire to the loft. The actors wanted to avoid a panic, which like laudable, so they announced that the fire was part of the show and that everyone should be calm and shouldn't freak out. But the audience did realize, and they freaked out, and they stampeded, and they had trouble getting out. There was only one stairway down from the cheap seats at the top, and it filled with smoke. No fire escapes, and some of the exits were locked to prevent against gate crashers, and people couldn't get out. The jury blamed the theater owners for not obeying the existing laws, and new laws were written, including not storing stuff on stage and widening exits. In 1882, the building code said that theaters had to have automatic sprinklers. This is the first kind of building in the city to require an automated response. What I find remarkable, though, is that this fire happened 9 years after the regulation said that tenants had to have safe exits. But none of these laws carried over. They were all very specific. It turns out they didn't carry over to other types of buildings, like hotels or schools or factories or offices. Even ships had their own horror story to get them to a fire code. Most of those I'm not going to talk about, we will look at factories in a minute. After even more tenement laws, we're getting proper, no kidding, tenement regulation at last, and it doesn't even take a devastating fire to get there. Thank you, Jacob Riis. In 1890, this guy, Jacob Riis, published a book about tenement life called How the Other Half Lives, and he did a lecture tour on it. And up until now, if you lived in New York City, not in a tenement, you could kind of avoid making eye contact with the fact of the tenements. You knew about it, but you didn't have to think about it. But here he came for the first time with photographs, and people were like, oh yeah, I guess that sucks. Well, you know, it was probably part empathy, part they were terrified of smallpox coming out of there, but whatever, they suddenly cared. I was really reassured when I read about this. Because up until then, it had all been, like, there was a horrific fire, and, you know, we had a very specific law, and then there was a different horrific fire, and we had a very specific law. And it was kind of mostly like that. But this one came from someone saying, wow, look how much this sucks, in a way that people could understand and relate to. And it was missing hope. Anyway, the next couple of tenement has acts included having to have actual windows, not air shafts, and your fire escapes can't be ladders anymore, or presumably like parachute hats. They had to have open balconies, and they had to be partly attached to the wall, and they couldn't be more steep than some gradient. Even better, your neighbors can no longer boil oil in the basement, which is good. And all new construction, and it turns out this is one of the most important things, though it seems subtle at the time, all new construction had to have interior fire partitions. Failure domains for the first time. So we're finally looking at stopping fires from starting and spreading, not just escaping from them. And best of all, it's all going to be enforced. Welcome to the 20th century, but it still sucks in factories. The Triangle Shirtwaist is the famous one, but the New York factory fire is this textbook disaster, so I wanted to talk about that briefly too. This building was shared by paper box companies, a nightgown factory, and a lamp manufacturer. But it had been previously used, it is like quite a combination, right? But it's been previously used by machine companies, so the floors and the walls are soaked in oil and grease. In two fire escapes, look at the size of this building. In two fire escapes, one of them ended up on a roof with no way down from there. The other was a really heavy ladder hanging from a balcony. It was an emergency plan that only worked for people with good upper body strength. And in this actual fire, this factory mostly employed young women, and in the actual fire, they weren't able to get the ladder down. So, one fire escape for a building this big. Fire started in the lamp factory. There was no fire alarm, so everyone evacuated the bottom three floors before someone realized the 116 people on the fourth floor had no idea there was a fire going on. The only door up to the fourth floor was kept locked, which was against the law, but they didn't care. People on the ground put a net and started catching people who were jumping from the fourth floor, but the net broke, and they only had one net. 25 people died, mostly from jumping, and 32 more were badly injured. The buildings department had condemned this factory 3 times. But the factory owners basically ignored that and kept going. And the buildings had 10 fires in 10 years. And it turns out that was expensive for fire insurance, as you might imagine. They didn't want another fire on their record, so they avoided calling in the firefighters, even though the firehouse was just across the street, because they thought they might be able to extinguish it and not go to 11 fires. Also, the victims had never been in a fire before. They had no idea what to do, so they quite reasonably freaked out. And this is what the officials grabbed hold of. When they investigated, they said the root cause was not the walls soaked in grease or delaying calling the firefighters or the locked door or the lack of fire escapes. It was that the girls panicked. Ugh. Human reaction to an outage is never the root cause. Humans will act in human ways. They are humans. If your systems can't handle that, and you haven't invested a ton of time in training humans to act in a non-intuitive way, the systems are crap. Anyway, so what happened? Nothing happened, nothing whatsoever. The jury didn't convict, though at least one juror later said that he regretted that. New Yorkers looked a bit at their factories and said, huh, yeah, that's a thing. And then nothing changed. I don't know why. I don't know if it's because New York is 10 miles away and we're so specific that we can only see things that happen on the island of Manhattan. I'm not sure. The New York fire chief said, this city may have a fire as deadly as the one in New York at any time. 4 months later, 146 people, mostly young immigrant women, died inside 18 minutes in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. This building was considered fireproof, but it was packed with garments. It's a garment factory. It was packed with garments hanging so tightly together that it might as well have been made of cloth. The building should have had three fire escapes, but it only had one. And that collapsed as soon as the police did, killing 20 people who just dropped from the seventh floor. One exit was locked, and the guy with the key escaped without unlocking it. The fire ladders and the water from the hoses, when the firefighters came, could only reach the sixth floor. The factory was on the seventh and the ninth. And the employers already knew. The previous year, employees had organized a strike to protest the building's conditions, and they'd been fired, and arrested on Friday. The building had had a warning notice from the Department of Sanitary Control, but they hadn't fixed their violations. The fire department afterwards developed a stronger water pump and a longer ladder. But more importantly, building conditions took a huge step forward. A commission was started to look into fire hazards and conditions in factories, and their recommendations became actual laws, 60 laws inside the next few years. Again, everyone knew that factories were bad, but when people died, specifically on the island of Manhattan, they changed the law. Sprinklers started being required in factories, but only factories over 7 stories tall, because very specific. A professional organization, the American Society of Safety Engineers, was founded as a result, and that still exists today. And people started looking at fire escapes differently. After the disaster, a report called them a pitiful delusion and a type of exit condemned by the experience of many fires. In 1923, the New York Times had an article praising fireproof interior walls. They said, for 6 years, there has been no loss of life by fire in the 200 buildings so treated, and the cost was less than fire escapes. It blows my mind that the fact that a group of 200 buildings had no fires, but no deaths from fire in 6 years was newsworthy. These fireproof walls became code. In 1929, all new buildings over 75 feet had to have them, and also had to have two fully enclosed staircases. Failure drains at last. Over the next few decades, the code made frequent improvements, and in 1968, fire escapes stopped being code. You're not allowed to build them now. The 1968 code also required sprinklers for hotels and high-rise office buildings, but not nightclubs and residential buildings. 1975, 7 people died in a nightclub, sprinklers from nightclubs. 1998, 2 very bad residential fires. Now sprinklers are required in residences with 4 or more units. This story is not over, this is just where we are to now, but I'm sure that we will add more and more very specific laws as we have more disasters. But there's no retrofitting of existing buildings. The laws only apply to new buildings. So the city very, very slowly is upgraded. Okay, thank you for staying with me for all of that. It's going to get more chill from now on, I swear. So the number of fire deaths didn't decrease because we built better fire escapes. It was because we built and operated better buildings. In the end, the things that made the difference were making it harder for the fire to start and spread, but for decades we optimized for escaping from it. Fire escapes are last resort plans. Like, even at their best, they kind of suck. Not everyone can get out a window. Windows get locked. People put air conditioners in them, and childproof fires that are also adult-proof. They get covered in snow and ice and stuff like bicycles and plants. They rust. They get detached from the wall. The ladder gets stuck. They make people really worried about burglars. If you leave windows open, fire blocks the path down. But most importantly, they never ever get tested. Fire escapes pretty much have one time of intense use, which is during a fire. If they're going to collapse, they're going to collapse during a fire. You don't find out they don't work until the only time you need them. If we're using a fire escape to escape a fire, a lot of things have had to go wrong. In fact, we have 3 chances not to be here. First of all, ideally the fire wouldn't have started at all. Something made the first spark. It's heat, fuel, and oxygen. And we could have stopped it before it started. Or we could have stopped it while it was tiny. Like, who hasn't set a dish towel on fire in the kitchen or burned toast? If you catch a fire quickly enough, it's just not a big deal. You just extinguish it and go on with your day. For bigger fires, like maybe there's a sprinkler system, which triggers automatically, it makes a mess, but you catch an off of a complete building outage. If we have proper failure domains, we can keep the fire or outage to one small part of the building or infrastructure, and at least make the fire spread very slowly, so we have time to react in a non-urgent way. But if we miss those 3 chances, we end up here at stage 4, urgently reacting to a fire that's out of our control. And if we're here, we probably care a whole lot about fire escapes, but it would be much better not to get to here. Look, I've illustrated these 4 points in a pie chart, because I just learned how to do that in Google Slides. Whether it's a building or a software system, the most important reliability work is making the problems not get to that 4th stage. Or at least I think it should be. I got a recruiter mail a couple of years ago that was like, our site reliability engineers are seen as firefighters. And I thought, wow, what a waste of your SREs. Like, I know there's this really strong association between SRE or production people and on-call and the pager, but that should be a really small part of our job. If your SREs or your production folks are focused on emergency response, you're wasting 75% of their skill set. And like, okay, everyone who's writing code should care about reliability. Like, no one should be like, oh, hi, I will write a precarious system, you know? But just as we have people who specialize in UI or security, even though all of us should care about UI and security, we have people who specialize in reliability. This is us. This is our community. And we should be involved at every stage. So, prevention, detection, isolation, and response. Let's look at those four stages again, but thinking about software this time. So something caused the first tiny breakage that caused the outage. Like maybe we changed something, or something got overloaded, or a user entered an input we didn't expect, or someone bulldozed a cable. A certain amount of sparks is fine. Like, some things are allowed to have more problems than others. We know what our SLAs are, and we have error budgets to decide how much breakage we can handle. But we have to stop those things from happening more than we can handle. This is a quote from Alan Ullman. We build computer systems like we build our cities. Over time, without a plan, on top of ruins. We don't need to build software like that. We can think about our stacks from the start with reliability in mind. We can spend time on high-level design review and try to find holes in the system before we build it. Next, catching bugs before they ship. We do this by having a second pair of eyes on our designs and our code, but also by writing good tests, both for the stuff that we think can happen as well as the stuff we think can't happen. Fault injection, like fuzz testing, is a good way to test input that we haven't thought of. And we validate everything. Even if you write the only caller of a function, you check what input you just passed yourself. Don't trust past you or future you. Assume that everyone who calls one of your functions, including yourself, is a monster who is trying to take you out. You've got to be paranoid. A stove igniter is a better tool than a box of matches. And a well-designed user interface is a better tool than letting users just muck around with any part of your code. So we design clean, safe interfaces that are hard to get wrong. We don't even give ourselves more access than we need to anymore. We use sudo, not root. Julie's talk, where's Julie, later, is going to talk about, she's going to talk about making safe changes. The fire department recommends that you don't operate a stove while drunk or sleepy. And the same goes for a root prompt or an admin console. Many outages are caused by changes. So we make them deliberately and carefully and with canary. We push the change to one place before we push to all the places. And we push out new features in a way that makes them very fast to turn off if we need to. And Heidi's talking about feature flags next. Over time, the best practices in our industry have changed. We mostly don't log in as root anymore. We mostly use config management and change control and repeatable builds. We socialize the idea of reliability in books and articles and at conferences. I mean, this is part of why we're all here, to see what the zeitgeist is, to see how we should be doing things. But okay, sometimes we still break things. We have two options for immediate response. We have humans staring intensely at screens, and we have robots. Robots are better. Alice Goldfuss said in, I think, her Monitorama talk last year, if you have 3-minute SLAs that you expect to be satisfied by a human, you don't have SLAs. And I so agree with that. Humans aren't fast enough for 4.9s. Smoke alarms need fine balance, as everyone knows who's burning toast and had trouble making it stop beeping at them, and then taking the batteries out, which please don't do that. Having humans react to small problems can burn them out. You're using up your gunpowder on small fires, and then you don't have enough left for the big ones. So ideally have a robot deal with anything that a robot can deal with, or make it all happen slowly enough that a human doesn't need to burn adrenaline to get involved. The less time that the reacting human spends on deciding what to do, the better. Like, if you're in a kitchen and there's an oil fire emergency, you don't want to stop and stare at your fire extinguisher to be like, is this a water fire extinguisher or is this a terrible idea? You want to be able to trust that the tools available do the right thing. So provide a one-click rollback for all of your changes. Let your on-caller put out the fire and then stop and figure out how it happened. But even better than automatic response is automatic recovery. There's a ton of ways we do this, especially at like low levels of abstraction. You know, if you drop a packet, TCP don't care. TCP just resends that thing. It's not going to page you like, packet is lost, please come and sort the situation out. We don't page for a failed checksum. We need automatic recovery like that higher up the stack. Like, if your tasks are flapping, you should be able to write that out. If a backend goes missing, you should be able to coast, at least for a while. If a machine dies, it should be replaced. health checking and load balancing should move traffic from an unhealthy region to a healthy region. Like, maybe you want to let humans know, but you want to let them know, like, oh, hey, there's a thing, you know, whatever, you've got a minute. Not, it is 3 a.m., a machine has rebooted, wake up. You don't want humans about this failing over, we'll just mess it up. Okay, stage three, there is a fire, it is happening. Now we want to not let it get on anything that it's not already on, or at least slow it down so we can catch it. And this gets us to failure domains. Failure domains split our infrastructure up so that only one part of it should be affected by any given outage. Maybe we've sharded our users over a bunch of different servers. Maybe we've got redundant network connectivity. If the problem's going to move around as components get overloaded, we want that to be slow enough that we can control and catch it, not an immediate cascade. Humans panic the first time they get paged, or the first time they hit a situation that's completely outside their comfort zone. They'll flail. They may make the problem worse. So fire drills help. Just as we make it incredibly common to hear a smoke alarm and sigh and find our way outside the building, we make it so that a disaster is never a surprise. At intervals, tell people you're doing a controlled outage and take a system offline. So it breaks. Let people get their panic out of the way while you're there staring at the systems. This also shakes out dependencies that you haven't considered. Like if you announce you're taking down some low SLA system for 10 minutes, you may find a ton of high SLA users who didn't know about it. And encumbrances and clutter. You know the phenomenon where you page for a thing, and as you're fixing it, you hit like an unintuitive command, and you do the wrong thing, and then the documentation is wrong, so you do something else wrong, and it takes forever to fix it? Thank you. Or you end up breaking something else? These traps. This is the basement full of straw. This is a fire hose with cluttered scenery on top of it. It makes it very hard for you to move around safely as you try to fix the real problem. Fatigue's another one. You're way more likely to make a mistake if you're exhausted. So set rules about how many incidents a person should be allowed response to, how many hours they should be allowed to be on call. Not how many they want to, but how many they're allowed before their on-call shift is over. If this means you have a whole lot of 4 or 6 hour on-call shifts, you paid your fires too much. You're burning out your humans. Okay, and sometimes this doesn't work. We don't have perfect software, so sometimes we do respond to outages. And we can set ourselves up for success. First off, the thing that broke my heart through a lot of those stories, don't lock your fire exits. If you know there's a potential disaster and you have a way to deal with it, don't disable it or don't make it so that it depends on the thing that just went down. Don't comment out your automatic recovery system, which is a story I've heard more than once. Don't take the batteries out of your smoke alarm. I'm just going to keep saying that. Please don't do that. Communicate about outages early. Make sure everyone knows there's a problem that needs to know. It is the worst when you're debugging something and after half an hour you get the notification that something else was down and causing it. And document your exits. Playbook entries tell the on-caller what to do, but they also tell the on-caller what not to do. Firefighters train using controlled outages, and we can too. We have drills to prevent panic. We can use them to speed up our response time. Wheel of Misfortune is our regular exercise where you pick an arbitrary outage and you just run through it and see what happens. So that was a kind of a whirlwind list of best practices, but there's nothing there that is new or not talked about extensively in books and conference talks. What I'm saying is that reliability can't be added at the end. If you're fixing a terrible system by focusing on the fourth stage, the emergency response, then you have a tenement. Foul air is coming in through the air shaft, and it's not somewhere that a human should spend time. Reliability and failure needs to be built in. This is a graph of civilian fire deaths in New York City. 71 people died of fire in 2017, 48 people in 2016. This is a lot of people, but it is the lowest on record, 48 in 2016, since they started recording 100 years ago. That Bronx fire in December that killed 12 people was the deadliest in 25 years. So how did we get from the fire traps of the 1800s, or indeed where it was remarkable that no fire deaths in 200 buildings in 6 years, to here? Well, this helped. This is the New York City fire code. It is 444 pages, and it costs $140, which I know because I really, really wanted to bring one in here and like wave it in the air. The guy in the library was like, you know, there's this thing called a website. Fire safety is also mentioned plenty in the City Building Code, the City Construction Code, the State Building Code, the National Fire Prevention Agency Electrical Code, and like tons of other legislation. I have no idea what the difference is between all this code. I'm just saying, there is a lot of code. But we don't have a fire code for software. We have a bunch of O'Reilly books, and they're really good. We make a valiant effort to document how we do things, but nothing makes us adhere to them or prioritizes one set of rules over the other. A fire code's been proposed from time to time. There's this amazing list called the Risks Digest about public safety risks caused by computers. I found on there this report from 1986 called Software, A Vital Key to UK Competitiveness, which probably, and it starts with, no computer software failure has killed or injured a large number of people. Yeah. It is just conceivable that such a tragedy could occur. And there's really detailed sections on disaster prevention and management. It includes this fantastic line, in spite of this, nobody trusts a computer, and this lack of faith is amply justified. I love that. The advisory council predicted a time when it wouldn't be possible to recover from software failure by just turning off the computer and having a human do the thing. This was written in 1986. I think we're there, right? They wanted certification. You could only run a life-critical computer system if you had a license and a certified software engineer and a bunch of other stuff. They proposed on-call shifts, disaster recovery practice drills, and postmortems, including for near misses. A lot of this feels really prescient, and we ended up doing it. But we never required certification. If you were at LISA in November, you might have seen this fantastic talk at the closing keynote by John Kuroda about aviation safety. It's really good. Like with fire, plane travel only got safer after a lot of bad accidents. John pointed out that we might think of our industry as kind of a new field, right? But it's the same ages as a bunch of others that we think of as very grown up, like aviation and nuclear power and emergency medicine. All of us took a big jump forward after World War II, but we're less mature than the others. Is that because the stakes are lower? Well, the Thera-25 radiation therapy machine had a concurrent programming bug that occasionally gave patients radiation doses that were like hundreds of times greater than they should have been. Three people died. In college, I remember studying the London ambulance dispatch failure. It was a software system that hadn't been load tested, and the ambulances ended up being hours late because nobody knew where they were. 26 people died who might have been okay if they'd gotten an ambulance. And I haven't heard any actual negative outcomes from the OCR bug in 2013, or did you see the medication autocorrection thing last month? In both cases, you could end up printing out a bunch of prescriptions that don't say what you think they said. So far, software's been able to kill people a few at a time. We haven't had wide-scale disasters, but increasingly we're using software for life-critical systems. And every month we send hug-offs on Twitter to people who are fighting the latest big software outage. At some point that will overlap. Are we ready for this kind of responsibility? This Indian tennis journalist who I love, Ines Weed, she said, it took a New York fire and a Triangle fire to bring New York State's fire legislation to its present inefficiency. But some regulations did come from fires. Like, a bunch came from people deciding to care about the same thing. We, all of us here, are people who care about reliability. We are the people who can decide to care. And we can make everybody else care. Well, that sounds kind of sensitive. We can encourage everyone else to care. Software is increasingly used for life-critical systems. And I don't want us to wait for a disaster to decide not to build tenements. We can choose not to be slumlords. We can decide now what good systems look like. We can create professional standards. We can create industry safety codes. And we can opt into a professional organization to keep ourselves honest. And then, just like the fire code, we can keep revising it and improving it until huge software outages are really rare, really shocking. The entire industry should learn from every major outage. We should not have secrets. Before I finish, the New York Fire Department and the Red Cross have this campaign to give people free smoke alarms, free batteries. They will even come to your house and install it for you. I just spent the last 6 weeks reading about devastating fires, which I don't actually really recommend. If you don't have a smoke alarm, search for Get Alarmed NYC and fill in their form, and they really will come install it for you. This slide lists a bunch of references that I found especially useful. That first one has a list of all of the others. So if you hit up noidea.org/fires, you get a lot of links to read more about fires and fire escapes, which again, I don't necessarily recommend, but it's sort of interesting. It includes some fires I didn't include here because I ended up with like 90 minutes of material. If you have comments on this talk, if you have questions, especially if you're a building historian who's willing to tell me what I got wrong, please come talk to me at the break or get me at, where is Tanya? Or fires at noidea.org. And everyone, please insist on fireproof software. That is all I have. Thank you very much.